Okay, so good morning and welcome to all. Today's topic is coal cargo. So we are going to study about coal. This is just a reference class just for the recording purposes, and half an hour class for the review of how is the class. So today we are going to study about coal cargo. What is coal? What are its properties? What are its hazards and main hazards, and what will be the precautions? Then how do we segregate and store the coal? What are the general precautions? And like ventilation and all. So first I would like to tell you that what is coal actually. Coal is nothing but the debris, or for millions and millions of years, the dead plants or animals which bury under the soil, and they keep making layers, and because of the pressure they decompose and emit the oxygen away. And the carbon which is left, which becomes brittle and hard over millions of years, and that forms the coal. So coal is nothing but decomposed dead end plants over millions of years due to pressure of the earth surface and layers. So here are some physical properties of coal. Like angle of repose here is not applicable because it's not a free flowing substance. Then bulk density, generally given in kg per meter square, here is 654 to 1263. This is just a general idea. Storage factor 0.79 to 1.53 meter cube per ton. The size can vary from up to 50 mm. And the class is MHB, that is material hazardous in bulk, is as per bulk carrier code. And the group is B and sometimes A. So this we will come to this later on in the class. It is liable to liquefy and possessing chemical hazards or not. As per that, the groups are classified, which will come later on. Now the properties and characteristics or the main hazards. So the first hazard or the first characteristic is that coals emit methane. So methane, which is CH4, which is a natural gas, and it's very important to know that it is a flammable gas. And fire is being the most hazardous situation or emergency on the ship. So if the coal is emitting methane, there is a flammable gas in the hold, and if it catches fire, it will be a very disastrous situation. So methane and air mixture, if they mix, so those of you who have studied, if there is 5 to 16% constitution of methane in the air, it can catch fire. That is the explosive range. So we have to be very careful and keep monitoring methane, and later on we will study how to take precautions so that fire due to methane does not occur. Then methane is lighter than air. We should know that methane is lighter than air. What does that mean? That it accumulates in the upper region of the cargo spaces or other enclosed spaces. So because it is lighter than air, it will be accumulated in the upper regions of the holds. So we have to make sure that the boundaries are air or gas tight. If the hatch cover is boundaries are air and gas tight, then the air will not come out and outside sparks something and it will not catch fire. Now, coals may be subject to oxidation leading to depletion of oxygen and increase of carbon dioxide in the cryospace. Coal itself is subject to oxidation, especially small pieces of coal. So they will react with oxygen and make carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide. But here we are talking about oxidation. So we just consider that it takes up oxygen, reacts itself and emits carbon dioxide. So it, if the oxygen is taken up by coal, it will be an oxygen deficient environment, which is dangerous for man entry, because humans need 21% of oxygen. So entry into the hold, it's a cargo hold is already an enclosed space, but we have to make sure that if it is coal, there will be deficiency of oxygen. Then some coals may be liable to self-heating. Now self-heating or spontaneous combustion, so it becomes heated up on itself, especially small pieces of coal, as we were discussing here, that it's liable to oxygen, oxidation. And small pieces of coal, when the air is circulating, they go on to the oxidation, and because it's an exothermic reaction, it starts combustion spontaneously inside the cargo spaces. Because small pieces will have some air gap because of the big pieces, and the air is circulating, it will absorb oxygen and the exothermic reaction will take place and spontaneous combustion can take place. The good part is that generally this spontaneous combustion will take place only in the small parts, small portions of the hold, not in the full cargo hold. Will be in small spots, so it's much easier to handle. Now, this spontaneous combustion can produce flammable toxic gases, which includes carbon monoxide. So, as we were discussing in the last, when it goes under oxidation and goes for spontaneous combustion, same time it emits carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide also. Now, carbon monoxide, we should know about carbon monoxide. Why it is dangerous? First thing, that it is toxic. It is toxic by inhalation, and it has a great affinity for hemoglobin in the blood. So it is very, very easily 200 times more absorbed by the blood, and moreover, it is toxic. So it is very dangerous for the human body health. And on top of that, it is an odorless gas and also has light. It is lighter than air, and it is also flammable. So it is a very dangerous gas because it is toxic, it is odorless, you can't see, it is lighter than air, so it will be on the top parts of the hold. It will try to escape also. It can be present near the holds if there is a leak or something, or the nearby spaces. And on top of that, it is flammable. So we have to be very, very careful when we are handling carbon monoxide. So we'll just repeat the main hazards of coal. First is emission of methane, which is hazardous because it's flammable, 5 to 16% of air. Then it is oxidation, it results in oxygen deficient atmosphere. Then liable to self-heating and carbon monoxide. Now the last one is, it reacts sometimes with water and produces acids, which causes corrosion, and the sulfuric acid or whatever is produced, the chemicals which are produced can be flammable or toxic gases, which includes, so when the coals, it reacts to some sea water ingress or some any fresh water due to rain, or any water ingress is there in the hold or self moisture content, the coal will react with that and it will produce some acids which can cause corrosion to that bulkhead or something. And there are some other gases emitted during the reaction, which are flammable or toxic gases, for example, hydrogen. So hydrogen is an odorless, lighter gas and also flammable. So we have to be careful about water ingress also. Now, segregation and stowage. So the boundaries of cargo spaces for coal should be resistance to fire and liquids. So as we saw in the last point that there can be fire, or that if there is a water ingress, then also there is a issue. So the bulkheads and the hold boundaries should be resistance to fire and liquids. If there is a fire in one hold, where water ingress in other one hold, it should not pass to others, or from any other tank or something, it should not pass to this hold. Also, in this context, I would like to tell that we have to be careful for the bunker tanks also, because if bunker tanks, when we are heating the fuel oil, if it is kept where the bunker tanks, which are very close to the cargo holds, and they are heated for use, then all they can also be the cause of creating self-combustion, spontaneous combustion in coal, and because of that also there can be a fire. So we have to avoid heating the cargo tanks which are in contact with the cargo holds which are loaded with coal. Now the coal should be separated from dangerous cargoes, and we have to consult IMDG code for that. So generally bulk carriers will load same cargo on all the holds coal. But suppose if you are loading coal and some other dangerous cargo also in some other holds, then it should be separated. That's the segregation requirement. So what is the requirement? It should be separated longitudinally by intervening complete compartment or hold from. Then storage of goods, the class of IMDG coal is 5.1. Then, what are the general precautions we will take? So as we were telling before, the hazards we studied, that is methane emission, carbon dioxide emission, spontaneous combustion, oxidation, and corrosion or emitting of flammable gases, hydrogen and all. So what precautions we will take? First is that before loading, the shipper should provide us with the shipper's declaration. And in shipper's declaration, all the characteristics of the coal should be mentioned. Now the next, we have to see in the shipper's declaration also, there will be mentioned that what group of cargo is there, what are the main hazards, and what is the safe handling procedures for loading and transport of the cargo. Then one thing we have to make sure here, sometimes the coal contains moisture also. So we have to make sure that it does not contain a lot of moisture. So we have to see the moisture content in the shipper's declaration and also the sulfur content. So for moisture content, there is a maximum limit for transporting coal with a moisture limit, which is called transportable moisture limit. If the moisture content is less than the transportable moisture limit, then only we can load that coal. So for this, we also have can test. So generally this happens when, suppose we are loading coal from Indonesia or somewhere in places in anchorages, and the coal is coming from barges. So because of the swell or from wherever, and the coal, depending on the coal heaps, if they are stored on an open ground, then because of rain and because of the swell when carrying through barges, it can contain a lot of moisture. And because of that, we have to make sure that the moisture content is below the transportable moisture limit. But exact moisture content which is mentioned in the shipper's declaration, we should not go 100% trust on that. because nobody knows the exact moisture content, because when it is raining or when the barge is coming, how long it is taking, how much swell or water it has got, we don't know. So we have to do a physical can test when we are receiving the coal, or we can see the condition physically also. But generally, it is with coal transportation, moisture content is generally not a big issue. Then the sulfur content, how much sulfur it contains. Then also the size and whether the coal is liable to emit methane or self-heating, if so. So it will be mentioned that this coal is self-heating or not, it emits methane or not. All these above hazards or characteristics which we discuss will be mentioned in this. So if it is there, then we have to take appropriate special precautions for self-heating, which we will discuss, like boundary cooling and all. Then bilges, all cargo space bilges should be clean and dry, any residues of previous cargo removed. So as we discussed that coal, and especially some special coals, are sensitive to reaction to water. So if the first thing is the bilges should be clean and dry and tested, because if there is any water ingress or self moisture is moving down, then we can immediately pump out the bilges. And there should be no previous cargo, because if there is previous cargo, then the bilges will be difficult or not able to pump out. So bilges should be clean, dry, free from previous cargo and tested for operation to remove the any water which is accumulated in the bilges. Then as we discussed, there can be flammable gases. So spark prevention by this point is that electrical cables and components in cargo spaces and adjacent spaces should be free from any defects and intrinsically safe for use in explosive atmosphere. So any equipment which we are using should be intrinsically safe. It should not cause any spark and covered. Then the vessel should have fully operational and properly certified and calibrated equipment for measuring below mentioned gases without entering into cargo spaces. So we discussed the emission of methane, carbon monoxide and other gases. Sometimes there can be sulfur also. So we should have a multi-gas detector, which should be able to measure like methane, which is by hydrocarbon, or oxygen and carbon monoxide. Then we should have measures for measuring the pH value, because we discussed that if the coal reacts with water, it forms some acids. So we should have some instrument to measure the pH value. So what is this instrument? Like, we have a pH paper we used to have in the 7th, 8th, 9th class chemistry lab classes also. It's a litmus paper or pH paper. And it will turn it colors if the solution is acidic or basic. So we take a sample from the old bilge sounding pipe, and put it on this litmus paper. If it is turning to acidic as per the color coding of the pH color code, then we will come to know that it is acidic, and as per that, we have to take some action or pump out the bilges. Then there should be a means for measuring temperature from 0 to 100 degrees centigrade at all times from commencement of loading without entering the cargo space. So the hazard which we discussed, that it is self-combustion or heating, or there can be fire. So all these things, for all these things, we should know the temperature. By temperature only we can know that there is an increase in temperature, or there is some small fire or something if it is increasing very fast. So we have to always monitor the temperature. So some latest ships might have a temperature sensor inside the hold, but generally most of the time we measure the temperature by a thermometer. So this, you know, the normal thermometer made of glass, and inside there is a mercury. So there's a chance of breaking. So it is enclosed in the steel tube, and the glass thermometer is put inside this, and there is a thread connected to this steel tube, and this is lowered into the temperature sounding pipe. Like you have sounding pipes, is a temperature pipe or temperature like a sounding pipe for each hole, and we lower the thermometers and keep it at least for 3 minutes. So when you are measuring the temperature, you have to make sure that you keep it for at least 3 minutes or one few minutes, and you have to measure the temperature at top, middle and bottom. These are the three levels which you have to monitor the temperature, because the fire can be at any place, we don't know. Maybe it is at the bottom and top temperature is showing okay because of the react closure, like exposure to the atmosphere. The top part of the bulkhead or tank top is exposed to the atmosphere, or bottom is exposed to the sea. So considering those things and monitoring the temperature and daily morning and evening, and also there is a log sheet given by the charterer or the manager, which you have to maintain, monitoring all the gases and pH value and the temperature every morning and evening, day, time, everything we have to enter into the cargo log monitoring sheet. Then we should have a SCBA. Obviously, if you have, there is some special circumstances like fire or something, and we have to make man entry. So as we discussed that the enclosed space entry procedures and the oxygen deficient atmosphere, so we need an SCBA, and there should be sufficient in number, and the crew should be adequately trained for donning the SCBA. Then general fire precautions, which we know that in cargo spaces and there, there should be no smoking, no naked flames, no burning, cutting, chipping or welding on the deck when the cargo is loading. And we have to treat this very seriously, because there have been many accidents that people thought that this is just coal cargo, there generally there is no gas, and they started just welding or something on the deck, and there was a full explosion in the hold, and one of the chief engineers had died who just went to do some inspection of the hold. So these precautions have to be taken as seriously as in the tanker, that there should be no smoking, no naked flame, and no burning, cutting or chipping or welding when the coal is loaded in the holds. Then also ventilation. Ventilation is also a very important point during coal. So the sources of adequate ventilation should be there. First thing is that generally we have mechanical ventilation, natural vents, and natural ventilation we have generally, sorry. And the air, you just open the vents and air will go in. So general guidelines for most of the coal, it will be given in the shipper's declaration, or it is mentioned that if any other specific instructions are not given, we have to keep the ventilation on for first 24 hours. And then as per the situation, we have to take care. Then do not store the coal cargo adjacent to the hot areas. As I told you, like bunker tanks which are heating or any other heating place, we have to make sure that the coal is not stored in closer to the hot bulkheads or hot areas. Then prior departure, surface of coal cargo trimmed reasonably level to the boundaries of cargo space. This prevents formation of gas pockets and air from permeating into the body of the coal. So trimming is very important. If it is not trimmed properly, then because of the gas pockets, there can be self-combustion or ingress of water can go more deep down. So to make sure that the cargo is trimmed reasonably. Then as I told you, we regularly have to monitor the atmosphere. Presence of methane, oxygen, carbon monoxide, and record is maintained as per the frequency asked by the charter or the situation. If there is an increase in temperature, then you have to increase the frequency of the monitoring, or if any of the other gases are increasing. Like for carbon monoxide, the limit is 50 ppm. So if it is increasing beyond that, you have to immediately consult the master, and master will consult the company and the experienced personnel of the company or the charter, and they will guide you. Sometimes it is that it is common for that cargo, but still we have to monitor cautiously at more frequency. And sometimes they will tell you about some special precautions, and there may be fire or something. Unless directly otherwise, all holds should be surface ventilated for first 24 hours after departure, as I told you. And during this period, one measurement should be taken from one sample point. So we have to take the measurements from, there are sample points on the deck, and we have to take the measurements from that. And after 24 hours, as per the methane concentrations, if they are acceptable. So we are ventilating mainly because initially whatever methane is there, it should be removed away and there should be zero methane. Otherwise, there can be a chance of fire, which we want to avoid. That's why we are ventilating. And so methane should be below acceptable low level, and ventilators after that should be closed. And if they are not with low level, if still the methane concentration is high, then we have to keep them open till the methane level concentration is achieved within the acceptable limit. Should be mentioned in your shipping declaration. Then ensure that all gases are emitted by cargo spaces do not find their way into the adjacent compartments. So the adjacent compartment, all should, weather tightness of the holds and other compartments should be tested. Then all enclosed spaces also should be monitored regularly for the monitoring of gases, like working spaces, storerooms, and records maintained for that. Then bilges should be tested regularly. Bilge sounding has to be taken daily and systematically, and bilges should be kept dry at all the times. If the behavior of cargo differs from that specified in cargo declaration, such differences should be reported. So whatever, if it is written self-combustion or heating and there is no heating, or any differences is there which is not as per the mentioned in the shipper's direction, then we have to report them. Then administration may approve alternative requirements to those recommended in this schedule. There can be some special requirements or precautions. So now we'll come to the precautions for each hazards which we are discussing. So now if there was emission of methane, so if it is advised by the shipper or analysis of the atmosphere in the hold indicates presence of methane more than 20% of the LA. So we were talking about this is important. What is the limit? So it should not be more than 20% of the LEL. Initiate below given special precautions. So if it is more than 20% of the LEL, what precautions will take? If methane is more than 20% of the LEL, what precautions will take for the hold? First is, we will maintain the surface ventilation, adequate surface ventilation to remove the methane. But on no account should the air be directed into the full hold or body of the hold, as it can promote self-heating. So make sure it is only surface ventilation. Then when accumulated gases prior to opening hatch covers or other openings, same to be done very carefully to avoid sparks, naked flame, or prohibited. Then ventilate the cargo holds or adjacent compartments and test atmosphere in them prior permitting entry into ensure gas clears away. So first, there should be no entry. If you are making any man entry, then main precaution is that there should be proper ventilation and checking of the atmosphere, and all enclosed space entry precautions should be taken. And entry only in the case of emergency. All enclosed space working should be adequately monitored on a regular basis, and mechanical ventilation should be intrinsically safe if there is a mechanical ventilation. And if the coal is self-heating, what precautions we will take? Then if the coal is self-heating, the analysis of the atmosphere in the cargo hold indicates that the increase in the concentration of carbon dioxide. So how we will know that it is self-heating and the temperature is increasing? When you are measuring carbon monoxide, the content is increasing. That is generally, as we discussed, due to the reaction, that means there is some self-heating in the hold. So obviously at that time, self-heating is taking place because of the oxygen, so we have to close the ventilation. So close all hatches immediately after completion of loading in each cargo space, and required seal the hatch covers also to prevent the ingress of air. Surface ventilation to be limited absolutely minimum to remove methane, and then close the surface ventilation. Forced ventilation never to be used. Air is not to be directed to the body of cargo, same like before. Personal entry with all the SCBA and infraspace entry precautions. Monitor carbon monoxide concentration at more frequent intervals. Then during loading, if temperature is more than 55 degrees, seek advice by the charter. So this is also a very important point. Then temperature should not be more than 55 degrees when we are loading coal. During loading and during the voyage also. Because it's a big chance of fire with that and self-heating. So when we are loading with the barges also, I remember well, like we are loading thermal coal in Indonesia and all. So we had this infrared gun, and with the infrared gun we used to check the temperature of the cargo in the barges. And if it is, or there is some steam coal also, coking coal, steam coal, thermal coal, these coals are generally very high temperature. Sometimes they can be even 55 degrees centigrade and more. So we measure the temperature with the infrared gun, and if we found that it is more than 55, we can legally reject the barge. And sometimes there is a procedure that if it is like very hot, like for example your tea is very hot, you just churn it up and down. Same way with the grab, they churn the cargo up and down and the temperature comes down sometimes. As per the P&I surveyor or some surveyor is there, in presence of that, if everybody agrees, we can allow the loading of the cargo. So make sure that the temperature at coal cargo is always less than 55 degrees centigrade. Then if carbon monoxide increases steadily, potential self-heating may be developing. Close the spaces and close all the ventilation. Then water should not be used for cooling the cargo. As we discussed, coal can react with water and make acids, so and some other flammable gases. So we cannot use water for firefighting, but we can use it for boundary cooling. Water is used only for boundary cooling of the cargo spaces. Maintain the compartment very comprehensive records of the log. And all this info, identity of the hold and monitoring of the gases, all this info in the log should be passed to the charter. Then whatever gas measuring instruments which we are using should be calibrated and serviced. We have to make sure. And the person who is using should be trained. If there is too much of carbon monoxide and there is some incident, then we should have a aspirator on board with flexible connection, which can be used in case of emergency. So here we complete about the coal. We'll just do a brief summary. We have gone through that what is coal, what are the physical properties, the hazards like methane, emission of methane, carbon monoxide, self-heating and corrosion. Then what are the segregation and storage requirement and the general precautions and the specific precautions for the hazards which we mentioned. Thank you and have a good day. If you have any doubt, feedback or suggestions, please feel free to write and we will respond to you soon about that. And we'll inform you about the next. Thank you.